I think as we got into this activity, you know, there really wasn't a cargo provider per se available to us. And so the COTS activity was geared towards just seeing, could we get a commercial provider to provide us with the information we needed, or provide a design, or give us this capability. So we started through that process. The schedule was stretching out a little bit. It was taking longer than the contractors or the SpaceX providers had anticipated. The other problem was that we can't use a SpaceX to actually deliver a service for the government. So when you require a service for a government activity, such as cargo resupply or cargo services, you need to actually then go into a formal contract mechanism, and that's a formal contract. So we were running COTS as just, could the capability be developed? It wouldn't be developed specifically just for the U.S. government. It was developed for the government potentially in the future, but no guarantee. But it was guaranteed for the private, or potentially the private sector, they could use this. So we were essentially just establishing a capability without an absolute government need. That's the purpose of a space act. A contract is when there's now a government need. So the dilemma was, shuttle was ramping down, so we had to establish the contracts much sooner than I would have liked to establish the contracts. In the ideal world, we would have continued through the COTS activity, we would have gotten to a very mature level, then we would have maybe taken a little period of time and then established the contracts. But because it was going to take so long to physically build the hardware to resupply station, the rockets that would carry the cargo to station, we had to start the contracts before the COTS activity was completed. And that is not an optimum by any stretch, but I had no choice. The shuttle was shutting down on a finite time frame to be ready to prepare and supply the station. We had to begin the contract activity before, rightfully, we should have. We probably should have waited till later, understood exactly where the contractors were, and we had to start the contract activity. Then there's another piece of this that I think a lot of people are confused about. It turned out the contractors chosen for the CRS activity happened to be the same contractors as the COTS activity. That was not a guarantee. Those were totally separate selections and totally separate decisions. The COTS activity was done under the Space Act Agreement, and there was no guarantee that those providers would be the same providers for the CRS contract. In fact, we got additional providers beyond those as part of the CRS contract, and it was just the essentially the merit of their proposals in the contract that allowed them to win the contract. So the fact that we carried forward both Orbital and SpaceX into the contract world was just happenstance. Kind of going back in history a little bit, the COTS selection was done by the Exploration Systems Mission Directorate, then the CR selection was done by my directorate. And so there was no tie, no relationship, nothing. And the fact that they ended up being the same contractor, it was just happenstance. And it's only because their proposals warranted it. So they were totally separate activities. And a lot of people think of them as a natural progression from the Space Act into the contract. And that is not the case. We did not do that. They were separable, different activities with a different fundamental purpose, different selection criteria, and we moved forward. But we were forced to do that very much earlier than we would have naturally wanted to do for the contract award. So essentially, we were awarding contracts to companies that really hadn't flown a rocket, they really haven't understood exactly where we were overall in cargo resupply. And, you know, it was a very risky point to actually make those awards with this kind of unknown entity out there. But that was driven by the fact that the shuttle was on a ramp down closeout period. We were able to protect several additional shuttle flights, which turned out to be absolutely critical. Even though we were told to end by a certain date on shuttle and only fly a certain amount of hardware, within the shuttle program, we stockpiled some extra tanks and extra hardware. We carried some contingency flights on our manifest because I knew that we would need some transition into this new world, even if the external political world didn't recognize we needed to have that capability to make that transition. So we carried those extra shuttle flights. We got about 4 extra shuttle flights than had been shown in some of the early manifests. That was absolutely critical. We then had stockpiled on station all the spares that we needed to run for an extended period of time. We had all the big, large components that only shuttle could deliver on orbit. And so we had stationed in the absolute best configuration. So if the cargo providers didn't come online at precisely the time that they had predicted, there was enough margin in the system that they could be delayed by several years and we would still be okay from an overall station operations, station research standpoint. So there was a lot of planning and forethought that went into the whole activity of how much we needed out of the shuttle flights. Both Congress and the administration were very supportive. They gave us those extra shuttle flights. We were able to fly some really critical equipment at that time that allowed us to bridge into this period where the transition took a lot longer than we had anticipated moving forward. So again, you know, you look at that, and in hindsight, it looks like a very well-organized, thoughtful, methodical, A follows B, follows C, follows D process. It wasn't that way at all. In foresight, we were kind of protecting the shuttle as much as I could in case some eventuality came about, but there was no guarantee that was going to happen. COTS was running at some speed. We were awarding contracts before we really had the true knowledge that it would be desired to go award those contracts. It turned out that the contracts also helped the contractors because it, again, essentially gave them another source of funding. So they not only had some of their COTS funding to use, but they had some of the contract funding to use as well. Sometimes the procurement laws wouldn't allow them to commingle funds between those, so they couldn't use the CRS, the contract funding for development. They could only use it for services, so they had to be very careful from a Security and Exchange Commission standpoint to make sure the funding stayed in the right buckets, but it did give them revenue to go spend to work on some of the services pieces. It was in a very dynamic period where you have an operational spacecraft that's absolutely dependent upon resupply. You have a resupply provider that is not even established, hasn't flown any rockets yet, and you're doing that transition and that dance all at the same time. And that's COTS, CRS, and ISS somehow getting through this whole period to end up where we are today, where station is an amazing facility, but it got through this period just because of extraordinary planning by the teams and being prepared for the worst and anticipating delays, anticipating schedule problems.